The need to feed, feeding the plant, feeding the soil, and especially feeding the seed. A good starter fertilizer is of great importance. We're in our mixing room here at our research farm, and our starter fertilizer is probably quite a bit different than what most people look at. What I mean by that is most conventional chemical farmers look at a starter fertilizer and they look at the NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. Maybe you'll put some copper, iron, zinc, and manganese in there because you've got some traces. There may be a little bit of moly, a lot of different things. You may be surprised at what we use. We use everything most people don't. I was in the Red River Valley several years ago with one of our good organic growers, and I was asking him if he used a liquid starter. And he says, oh boy, he says, we've got heavy, high magnesium, very compactable soil. The last thing I want to do is put a bunch of liquid weight on the tractor or the planter just because of compaction problems. He says, if you want me to think about a starter fertilizer, you're going to have to give a very compelling story. So he says, go. And I said, well, number one, when you plant a seed in the soil, you're hoping and waiting for the moisture that's in the soil to soak into the seed, and you're hoping that water that is draining through the soil has the right nutrients to give the seed the energy to germinate and grow. What do I mean by that is, when you look at a seed is a composite of everything that plant needs to start its life. Now, several years ago, I read an article in a soybean journal written by a university, an agricultural university. The article was The Need to Feed. And the subtitle, or the caption is, Soil Fertility Can Be a Yield-Limiting Factor. And so they give a list of nutrients on how many nutrients a bushel of soybeans extracts from the field or takes off the field. A bushel of soybeans will take about 4.9 pounds of nitrogen, 1.1 pounds of phosphorus, 2.4 pounds of potassium, and 0.4 or 4/10 of a pound of sulfur. This is for each bushel that is harvested. Common thinking is, well, shoot, if those are the numbers, we take that times how many bushels we want, and that's what our fertility program is. Kind of a no-brainer. Me being kind of a disruptor, it's like, wait a minute, let's add this up. 4.9 nitrogen, 1.1 phosphorus, 2.4 potassium, 4/10 of a pound of sulfur, that adds up to 8.8 pounds, not even 9 pounds. What's a bushel of soybeans weigh? 60? Okay. So they've given us less than 9 pounds of what a bushel is made up of. That's less than 15% of what a bushel of beans should weigh. What's the rest? And why didn't they tell us this? These are some of the secrets that I think have been kept from us being growers. So if you look at a healthy seed is plump, it's full, it has a heavy test weight, and it has a wonderful, quick, solid, even germination. If you look at that seed, and if that seed was given everything it needed during its lifetime of growing the previous season, about 47% of that seed on a dry matter basis would be carbon. 43% of it would be oxygen, and 4%, ballpark, would be hydrogen. So we've got carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen. They didn't mention it here. Why? I don't know. Maybe you should ask them. What we look at is we're trying to make up the deficiencies that a seed may have. In our starter fertilizer, we'll put 20 grams, yes, 20 grams of our calcium in there, a couple pounds of organic sugar, not more than 2 gallons of liquid fish fertilizer, a couple pounds of micronized soft rock phosphate, and then we throw in some biology with some carbon, and then we also put some molasses in there. Okay, why the sugar, why the molasses, why all the fruitcake stuff? Well, carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen combined in a certain way is sugar. Simple sugar that a plant makes when it lays its leaves out, grabs sunlight, water, and minerals, a simple sugar that the plant creates is 6 parts carbon, 12 parts hydrogen, and 6 parts oxygen. That makes up 94% of the plant is the components that make up sugar. If your pH is too high, you don't have any hydrogen. Check the base saturation. If your pH is over 7, you don't have any hydrogen. You're wondering why your plants aren't healthy? Take hydrogen out of the equation, the plant can't make sugar. If you're low in carbon, less than a 16 to 1, 20 to 1 carbon to nitrogen ratio, you don't have any food for the microbes to make carbon dioxide, which is part of the carbon cycle. If your compaction is over 150 psi using a penetrometer, you don't have enough oxygen. You wonder why your chemical bills are too high. You wonder why your nitrogen bill is too high. Well, if air can't get into the soil, i.e. over 150 psi of surface tension, if the air can't get in the soil, there goes your free nitrogen. 78% of every breath we take of atmospheric air is nitrogen. And if the air can get pushed into the soil, the microbes, the nitrogen fixers, will start grabbing that nitrogen from the atmosphere and turning it into plant usable nitrogen. The purpose of a starter fertilizer is to make up any deficiencies or inadequacies that your soil may have. Most soil has a deficiency in oxygen. It has a deficiency in carbon. And many times in the top 2 inches where your seed is placed, it has a deficiency in calcium. Let me explain that for a second. Calcium is one of the heavier minerals in the soil, and with rain and weather, it migrates down. The only way it's going to come back up is through a weed root. Yes, I said a weed root. Those big, ugly, nasty weeds that are growing in your neighbor's field, not yours, of course. Those weeds are trying to pull calcium up. A little bit of calcium in the soil on the seed, right in the furrow, right in the slot. We have calcium, we have sugar, we have molasses. What we're doing is with the sugar and the molasses, we're putting the carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen that that seed may very well be deficient on right in the slot so that plant can get a good, solid growth. So with our farmer in the Red River Valley saying he doesn't want to do a starter fertilizer because of the potential compaction, I said, here's where we're at. We've got carbon, we've got oxygen, we have hydrogen in this mix. We've got liquid fish fertilizer that's all the goodies ground up and liquefied from a fish along with sugar, molasses, calcium, and phosphorus. And what we're doing is we're putting a slot of goodies right where the seed is placed. That allows the seed to germinate faster, stronger, more uniform. And here's the cool thing, is the calcium, the sugar, the molasses, the liquid fish fertilizer, the soft rock phosphate, all those things are all ingredients that weeds do not like. Weeds do not like all the good things that your crop does. So we're creating an environment to get that baby seed a nice shot of life to get up and started. It's only to get it up and out of the ground and to get its roots going. Be careful when you're looking at a lot of different fertilizers. Salt and sodium can actually burn, and a weed will actually enjoy that, whereas your plant will actually grow away from that high salt, high sodium fertilizer. I didn't mention any nitrogen in our starter fertilizer. We don't put any in there. Why? Because nitrogen has been oversold for 50 years, 60 years, probably 70 years. A plant wants to be made up of carbon and oxygen and hydrogen. 47 carbon, 43 oxygen, 4% hydrogen. That's what it wants. That's a composite of sugar. That's part of the composite of CO2. That's two of the elements of water, H2O. Your nitrogen bill will not go down until you increase your carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen in the soil. Nitrogen is needed by the plant, but you don't need any more than what the air has, if that air can get into the soil. If your microbes have air and food to take that nitrogen and break it down to make it plant available, and if you have life in that soil with the carbon, you need no extra nitrogen. On our research farm here, we are organic, and we've been organic. And everybody's saying, well, what are you gonna do for nitrogen? And I say, well, take a breath, we'll figure it out. They didn't understand it was a simple, sick joke on my end. The nitrogen is in the air. So the combination that we have with our calcium that starts feeding the microbes, and the sugar and the molasses and the soft rock, and the microbes and the fish and everything in there, we have a cocktail that we mix up right up here in our own mixing room. We see solid, consistent, uniform germination, and also we can row a crop normally in 4 to 5 days. It's even, it's up, because we've given that plant probably what we think it's short of, and we see a nice uniform germination. With this, it's a good start, but now I'm going to throw you a curveball. Trent, our farm manager, did some tests like we do every year, and he did some spots where he did not use our starter fertilizer. Oh my gosh, that could be a catastrophe if you've seen what a good starter fertilizer can do. Our starter fertilizer will get that seed up and going, but where our carbon to nitrogen ratio in our soil was low, what I mean low, under 16 to 1, it didn't matter whether we put a starter fertilizer out or not. One other thing that he also did is we normally fertilize on a foliar basis. We will try to give the organic corn and the organic soybeans 4 to 5 foliar feeds a season. He did some parts where he didn't do any foliar. And those parts, some of them were also where he didn't do a starter. Where we had done a test several years ago where we spread raw liquid dairy manure, our carbon to nitrogen went down to a 3 to 1. It didn't matter what we did or didn't do on that ground. If the carbon is low, nothing else matters. So many growers, we get comments from you on email or on a phone call and say, yeah, what we're doing isn't working. Well, my dad always used to say, when we were going off in different directions, either chasing or working cattle or working in the field, he said, if something breaks or if you need something, figure out how to get along until nightfall, and we'll fix it at night. He says, if you think you can fix it, look for the cheapest, easiest fix that makes the most sense, and then move on. I'm trying to follow my father's footsteps. Look for the cheapest, easiest fix. Get a good penetrometer. Check to see if you have surface tension or tightness, compaction in your soil. Get a carbon to nitrogen test on your soil to see what that carbon level is. And don't let somebody confuse you saying, well, soil organic matter and carbon and nitrogen is the same thing. It's not. All of these smart alecks are trying to say soil organic matter is the same thing as carbon. It's not. Many times when the pickup goes by with the hydraulic soil probe, they punch right through the residue. And a lot of the residue that the no-till farmers have or the minimum-till farmers have, that's counted as soil organic matter. And if it's on top, it's still residue. It's still trash. It's still fodder. It's still last year's crop or stubble. It is not soil organic matter until it's been broken down once and put into the soil. That's why they call it soil organic matter. Soil organic matter is residue biologically broken down once. The carbon to nitrogen ratio is the creator of humus. Humus or protoplasmic gel is the breakdown of microbes that have eaten, have partied, have reproduced, and passed away. That protoplasmic gel is pure adrenaline to a plant. The nutrients that we use in the starter fertilizer are the same nutrients we use to feed the microbes and also to feed the plant. This may be a twist that you haven't thought about. A lot of people say, well, what does a microbe like? Because there's all these different species and there's all these different strains, and then you got mycorrhizal fungi, you got all this stuff. What do they like? Well, guess what? They're the prep cooks for the plant. The plant wants the same thing that the microbes want. What are the top four things the microbes want? Available calcium, available phosphorus, carbon, and oxygen. And then we can go from there. If you don't have available calcium and phosphorus, those are the first two minerals a plant needs to make photosynthesis. Calcium and phosphorus are the first two minerals needed for the microbes in the soil to make their skeletal system, whether it's an internal or external, endo or exoskeleton, they have to have a little calcium and phosphorus for their physical integrity. The carbon and oxygen, that's the fuel. That's also the plant's immunity. One of the things we look at after emergence, after we can grow a plant, as soon as we get enough plant where we can squeeze the juice, we check the bricks with a refractometer measuring the photosynthetic process of that plant. A lot of people say, well, why would you do that? Because a good start many times help give a good finish. Here's more of a direct approach with that. When you can be above 8 bricks of sugar, the plant has immunity against detrimental, disease-causing fungus, algae, and mold. When that plant first emerges, it just catches sunlight for the first time, and if it has eyes, it's probably squinting a little bit going, oh, wow, awful bright out. It's gonna start grabbing sunshine, and it's gonna start making sugar. The quicker it can make sugar, the better the chance that plant has to be chemical-free, be nutritious, have a shelf life, give a good test weight, and be profitable. We're going to talk more about bricks in the very upcoming future, but don't just look at the end result of checking the sugar content. Also look at the starter plant that gets a good start with a good liquid fertilizer program that doesn't have chemicals or synthetics in it, and you're off to the races. I'm Glenn. We're SoilWorks. And any comments, questions, or concerns, email us or call us. Look forward to talking to you. Thanks for watching.